Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Analytics Illustrated panel. My name is Amal Mapani. I'm a first-year MBA student at MIT Sloan and a student lead for this panel. I'm very excited today to introduce to you Kirk Goldsberry, a writer for Grantland and a visiting scholar at Harvard University. Please enjoy the panel.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you. We got some sort of MacGyver-esque AV going on, so I have to advance the slides a few different ways, so hold on. But I want to start by just with an open about Daryl Morey and the Rockets. I thought that would be an appropriate way to start. So, you know, Daryl started this conference, and this conference has been really important to me. And so I just wanted to talk a little bit about a piece I wrote earlier this fall, earlier this season. Does anybody know what that is? Okay. I'm proud of this. I made this portrait of James. But I don't know where the slides just went, guys. But this chart here, this really started it all for me at this conference 3 years ago. So I really wanted to start with this, and I'll get back to the Rockets in a second. But this chart here, or one like it that I made for the Sloan 2012 conference, where I essentially told the audience that I thought shot charts might be a good idea. I was saying, this really explains a lot of Daryl's philosophy, at least his offensive philosophy in the Rockets organization. And it explains both the efficiency and frequency of NBA shooting in terms of points per shot over this season. As you can see, there's really a really efficient area near the basket and around the three-point line. So that's kind of a callback to that 2012 paper I wrote. And when you look at where the Rockets shoot this year, you know, you see that they stay away from this greenish mid-range zone. And we all know that. And when you look at the efficiencies through the lens of my shot chart, you see, oh, they appear to be inefficient. But one of the things they do is they know that inefficient shots in good neighborhoods are still better than efficient shots in bad neighborhoods. By the best house on the worst block, the NBA version, I guess. And then James Harden, who I believe is the smartest practitioner of basketball right now in the world, I want to talk a little bit about him. And he's sort of Daryl's perfect monster. All threes and attacks near the basket, and of course he gets to the line a lot. However, there's something that you don't know about James Harden, probably, and that is that he is also really good at helping his teammates. So any team that wants to shoot a lot of threes needs somebody to create a lot of threes. Let me say that again. Anybody who wants to shoot a lot of threes needs somebody to create a lot of threes. 85% of NBA threes are assisted. All right, this graphic I made last year for a piece on John Wall. You can see in the corner, the assist rate in the NBA is near 96, 97%. So the official smart guy shot in the NBA requires assistance. Almost all the time. So the people who are trying to shoot more corner threes are actually people who are desperate to help create more corner threes. And nobody has assisted more corner threes this year than James Harden. And it's not close. Interestingly, Josh Smith, the day he arrived in Houston, was fifth on that list. So this is really a match made in heaven, because you have a guy who really can execute this newfangled basketball strategy, and the architect, and I thought it would be a good place to start, because it brings back my 2012 start at Sloan, which is really important for me, and Daryl a little bit. Now, I have to address some of my colleagues at Grantland who aren't here. There's a lot of people at Grantland, not me. They don't like watching the Houston Rockets play basketball. They think it's ugly. They think it's ugly basketball. I'm not one of them. However, if you have a problem with James Harden or Daryl Morey, it's not their fault that the league decided to make a 24-foot shot worth 50% more than a 22-foot shot. That's not their problem. These are the rules that they're playing in. It's not their fault that you get two free throws when you careen through the paint and run into another player. It's not their fault. If you don't like the Houston Rockets and what they're doing, your problems aren't with the Rockets, they're with the competition committee. They're with the lines that they painted on the floor. They're just the best at exposing margins in the game right now. All right, so the haters are gonna hate. But this brings me to a sadder part, you know. And this, you know, I grew up in the 80s watching players like Alex English or Bernard King, you know. And you can't be Alex English anymore. And what I mean by that is we all knew the league is shooting a lot of three-point shots. This is a line graph. I'm sorry if it's hard to read. The message here is this is when the three-point line started. This is now. This is a three-year period where they moved it in, if you remember that. And they moved it back out. I wonder why. Maybe they thought there were too many threes. Well, now we're way up here. So three-point shooting is obviously what's happening in the league right now. And what is the casualty of that? And again, it makes sense. If you look at points per shot in the league, you don't have to be a rocket scientist, no pun intended, to know that threes and layups are the way to go offensively. However, when you look at the points per shot and distance, you start to see a devaluing of two-point shots outside of 3 feet. And the players that are really good at making those shots are becoming less valuable. And players like Danny Green or Steve Novak become extremely valuable. And then the Phoenix Suns drafted T.J. Warren this year, who was one of my favorite players in the sort of throwback sense because he was really good at creating baskets at efficient rates in the paint or near the free throw line, those little 8-10-foot shots, Dwayne Wade shots. So watching Warren play and thinking about guys like Alex English and Bernard King makes you realize how much the game has changed. King was masterful in an area that you might call the inner mid-range. The two-point area is between 4 and 16 feet. Highly defended court space, which only truly skilled athletes can score offensively. Warren is one such player, and he came into the league looking confident and athletic in possession. Long story short, he's not getting a lot of playing time. So during the last NBA season, 78 players attempted at least 150 shots between 4 and 16 feet. Only two of them made half of those attempts. Dirk and anybody? Dwayne Wade, right? So these are two really good players, very different players, but they're really good at that. T.J. Warren is good at that. T.J. made over half of his 200 shots in that range at NC State, but he's having trouble finding a way in the league. Conversely, he can't shoot from three, so he's going to have to change to fit into the contemporary NBA. So, you know, any league obsessed with three-point shooting is going to have a casualty. So, you know, these guys are on to something. But here's the sad part. The three-point line has eroded the value of players like Warren. It's sad because scoring like Bernard King or Alex English used to do requires equal parts intellect, athleticism, and practice. I would argue it's pure basketball, right? Pure basketball. Guys who can score in that way are pure basketball scorers. Hitting a left shoulder half hook over Roy Hibbert is like blowing a fastball by a cleanup hitter. But we're devaluing the guys who can do this, those little 10-foot shots, with the new legislation in the NBA. So I have no problem with what Daryl and James are doing. In fact, I think it's very intelligent. But as a fan of aesthetics as well, I think it's time to sort of give pause to the idea that the players that are sort of being lost here are also really good basketball players. All right, so I'm going to hit on like four or five things. I think I can keep your attention if I change the subject a lot. That's my strategy. So I'm going to talk about how I got here a little bit. So I got to go back. I wrote this paper 3 years ago at Sloan, Court Vision, and I'm embarrassed by it now, but I'm sort of proud of it at the same time. But it's essentially like, hey, all this new performance data, why don't we use spatial analysis and visual analytics to help sort of give interfaces to these emerging forms of basketball data? And that was one of the most fun weekends of my life. It was crazy. I was a professor at the time, and I was interacting with these wild NBA folks, and it really changed my life. I really like this headline, "What Can Geography Teach Us About Basketball?" And then in that summer after my first Sloan conference, I did this. This was kind of my big break in the media world. I got this finals preview with the New York Times and worked with Joe Ward and the amazing NYT graphics crew to present that. And that was sort of how I started getting involved in media. And then Bill Simmons was nice enough to let me write for Grantland, and one of my first big things I did with them was write the Kobe assist to prove that I could be more than just the shot chart guy. And that was a really fun project to work on. And then in March, I wanted to talk to you about this LeBron project, which was my favorite project at Grantland to date, where I got to go down to Miami and look at analytics with LeBron and talk to him about how his game had changed up until that point. And so, I wrote this piece called, I forget what the editors called it. I called it one thing and then they changed it, but that's what they do. But I showed LeBron this chart when I first got to Miami and I was nervous. He was the second NBA player I'd ever talked to. And I was really nervous and I put this in front of him and he said, that's some unique shit, man. So I knew I was onto something. I was like, this is just a plot of your shots. It's not that great. But he was cool. He was really into it. And one of the things I wanted to do with him, because I think at that time, if you remember, LeBron was hated. Talk about haters. Like, nobody had more haters than LeBron in 2013, you know, 2012. But I maintained that anybody who got that good at the sport I loved had to have a pretty high basketball IQ, if you want to call it that. And I wanted to sort of think about how, or talk to him about how he approached his own player development and look at the data. And so we looked at charts together, and this is where I really sort of found my favorite thing to do now at Grantland is to talk to a player, ask him about how he approaches scoring, and then sort of integrate the quotes from the guy himself and the data and the narrative and really talk about it. And LeBron was the first one I did and still I think the best one I did. So we talked about how his game has evolved from his last year in his first Cleveland administration. Through the first few years in Miami. And just really quickly, you know, his last year in Miami, you say, oh, I'd play on the ball a lot. I was essentially a point forward, and you can see in these really coarse shot, these are just his most common shot locations where he was shooting the ball. And then we moved to Miami, had a very different ecological reality with Dwayne Wade all of a sudden, and he is playing more off the ball. He's moving over to the left side of the court. There's more paint. There's fewer threes. And then if you remember this year, this is the year that Dallas beat Miami in the NBA Finals. And LeBron essentially got pissed off and he wanted to get better. And so he went to Houston and worked with Hakeem Olajuwon and wanted to develop a post game. And he stopped shooting threes. And so when they won the championship, you see this completely different player spatially. He stopped shooting threes, and you see that left block where he had worked so hard with Hakeem that wasn't there the previous years. And so it was really cool just as a proof of concept to see an athlete interact with this data set, interact with these graphics, and have this feedback, this intelligent conversation about what was going on tactically in his head, how he saw it, and then tell readers about that and show readers these changes in ways that weren't really common back then. And so I'm still really proud of that. That was sort of a breakthrough for me as a Grantland writer. But when we talk about, I told you I'm going to change the subject a lot just to keep you guys interested. But so when I think about sports analytics right now, I was thinking, what could I talk to these people about? Well, I think there's three shortcomings when I think about sports analytics right now. One kept coming up yesterday, which is like, what are analytics? I don't think we even agree on what that means. And I think if we do agree, we have a very, very narrow conception of what that means. And I think that is a big shortcoming. So what are analytics? What is an analytic? I remember I had one friend in the league argue to me the fact that Chris Bosh is left-handed is an analytic. How many of you think the fact that Chris Bosh is left-handed is an analytic? I do, and I'll tell you why. How many of you think the fact that Dirk Nowitzki is a stretch four is an analytic? Yeah, I do. How many of you think the fact that Charles Barkley is a stretch mark four? Have you guys heard the stretch mark four bit? I can't take credit for that. So, you know, Kant didn't come up with the term stretch mark four. That honor belongs to my friend and colleague, the philosopher David Jacoby. And before we can give the people what they want here, we have to first agree on what analytics even are. I think the fact that somebody's left-handed is a reasoning artifact that helps me characterize the nature of the phenomenon. I think it's the product of a simple analytical process. Kant was talking about analytical reasonings far before Microsoft Excel, far before computation of any kind. And so I think one of the problems with sports analytics is we don't really even know what we're talking about, and we're starting to reinvent wheels. And I think from my perspective, you don't have to agree with me, I'm just trying to get at something from my bizarre geographic background. So Mike Zarin was giving a little thing yesterday on the panel in basketball analytics, and he said, who thinks sending a scout to a game is analytics? Does anybody think scouts are analytics guys? Yeah, I do. And I'll tell you how I came to appreciate that. So right now, there's a scout sitting in some airport in line at a terrible coffee shop, and he knows more about the game of basketball than I'll ever know. And he knows more about every player in the NBA than I'll ever know. And he's seen every kind of zipper cut ever been run. He knows every kind of head case there is. And he spent years of his life generating reports and concocting reasoning artifacts for his bosses that support knowledge construction. They're artifacts in analytical discourse. And if you've seen the movie The Trouble with the Curve, which I haven't, or Moneyball, there's always this conflict about the nerdy analytics guy with crooked glasses and the scout, and they have a fight, or they don't like each other or whatever. That's not new. In social science, I'm a social scientist, we talk about qualitative and quantitative social science. They're both very acceptable forms of social science. And in fact, the best departments of geography or psychology or political science each have practitioners of qualitative and quantitative science working together on research. I would argue the scouts, maybe you could classify them as qualitative social scientists, but they're no less analytical than somebody who's working in R or Excel. And I think that's a big problem we're having, is just agreeing on who is doing analysis. And analysis itself is obviously much older than computation. I think we all agree with that. So, before we can really discuss the state of sports analytics, I think we'd have to agree on what analytics even are, and I don't think we can do that. But for me, as a basketball analytics writer, it's liberating to admit that I know less about basketball than a lot of these people. Trust me, if you have one conversation with my friend John Yim, who's a video coordinator of the Portland Trailblazers, you'll quickly realize that you don't know anything about basketball. If you talk about any assistant coach in the league or in Division II basketball, you'll learn a lot from those people. They know things. You know, we're all analysts. My friend Ben Alomar, who is running analytics for ESPN now, wrote a really good piece last week or 2 weeks ago in describing his experiences working with the Sonics and Thunder and Cleveland. And he had the same realization that, you know, you walk into these rooms full of basketball geniuses. They may not use computers, but they're analysts. And we have to approach that with a certain humility, and I think the community sort of struggles with that. But there are all kinds of basketball geniuses. Many of them are qualitative, many of them are quantitative, some of them are players. So You know, and now we have to talk about maps because this is Kirk Goldsberry talking, and I'm a geography nut. So with all this in mind, as a social scientist, it's my opinion that maps are not only analytics. How many of you think maps are analytics? I have a few allies, so I have to do some convincing here. I think they're the most potent analytical forms in human history. Consider the sheer amount of information encoded on this display right now. Aside from the infinite amount of topological relationships that are qualitative and quantitative, they're congruently representing the environment in a way that no other document can do. There are literally thousands and thousands of numerical observations on this display. And if I need to convert you, you could put thousands of numerical observations in any kind of form. Spreadsheets are really terrific. Tables are really terrific. Visualizations. And often they're very appropriate. You could store all of this bathymetry data in a spreadsheet or a database. But this is the most congruent representation of the phenomenon. All right, and that's really the key of what I do as a geographer working with basketball data, is building congruent graphics. So if we can't agree on what analytics are and aren't, we can't really talk about what needs to get better in the field. I think that visual analytics, which sounds like a buzzy term, is actually an emerging field within computer science about building visual interfaces to large data sets. Okay? This beautiful topo map of Switzerland is a visual interface to topographic data, and it's hundreds of years old. All right? And it's a masterpiece. So maps have always been called the geographer's tool, and within geography, my specialization has always been cartographic in nature, but they blend qualitative and quantitative elements together and help us understand something that we didn't understand. They empower us to reason about the world. So with that in mind, I think, you know, another issue I'm seeing with sports analytics, whether we're talking about sports psychology or we're talking about visualization, we're talking about a lot of reinvention of wheels. And, you know, I think it's fantastic that we're seeing emerging forms of visualization in sports, but it's not new. And we have a lot to learn from masters that are dead and map libraries that are not very commonly visited anymore. So I'll get back to basketball in a second, I promise. So when we talk about data visualization, we're talking about a field that's often framed as a newfangled thing, you know, some motherless child. It's not a motherless child. You know, map libraries are littered with examples that predate computation of visualization masterpieces that have changed the world. You know, Edward Tufte, who's obviously a leader in this field, presented some examples yesterday that are certainly older than computers. But when we talk about making maps, what are we really doing? And this is, I'll bring it back to sports in a second. You know, we're talking about mapping a worldly phenomena. The data set is the necessary middleman. And then we make a representation of the worldly phenomena. The data empowers us to do that. But we don't want to see data. We want to see the worldly phenomena. We want to see a model of that. We want to see a visual model of what's going on the ground. We don't want to see data. So I think the term data visualization actually frames the activity incorrectly. Data are for robots. Data are for computers. Those are storage. They're necessary. I love them. I use them every day. But they're middlemen. We really want to build representations of what's going on the ground or on the court. So I don't like the term data visualization. All right, that was a little professorial. Sorry about that. So this graphic, for instance, could be made 1,000 different ways, but it looks like a map and it's a sports graphic. You know, Mercator's map of the world from 500 years ago is a data visualization, I suppose. So getting back to, is this an analytic? I think it is. And if you had spent years of your life teaching cartography at Michigan State or Harvard, and stared at maps like this and instructs the students how to make maps like this, when it came time to make maps for Grantland about sports analytics, you might make maps that look like this. And how I view my work is just not inventing anything, just extending the line of previous artists and scientists into maybe a newer domain. But I'm certainly not inventing anything. So I do think we struggle with reinventing the wheel when we could learn from past precedents, whether we're talking about basketball scouts or cartographic masters who've been dead for 400 years. All right, we're almost to the part where I talk about basketball again. So this idea of landing the plane in Sausage Town, this is something that I think is really important. And it's a silly frame, but you know that saying, like, nobody wants to see how the sausage is made? Well, I think analysts are really obsessed with the how the sausage is made. And as scientists, you should be. And peer-reviewed journal articles are very important devices for communicating how you made the sausage. But when you're talking to a general manager or a scout, they don't care about your hidden Markov model, right? They don't care about that. And we really, when I talk about landing the plane, so many analysts do really good work. They have a really good project, they have really good methods, they get really good results, but they can't land the plane. Landing the plane is explaining this to somebody else. All right, that's the new challenge. And I'll talk about this later. 10 years ago, the bottleneck was, where's this data? How can we get this data? My friend Devin here in soccer, where are we gonna get this soccer data to do this stuff? Now we have way too much data. Now we're swimming in data, and now the new bottleneck is, how am I gonna deal with this and communicate this to my friends, to my coworkers, to my audience? That's where landing the plane comes in. You do your project, you find something cool, you're halfway done. Congratulations. Don't tell me about your hidden Markov model, unless you're writing for an academic audience. I don't know what you have to cheer about at Knicks games these days, Paul Simon. I don't know what you're clapping about, Kate Upton. Have you seen these guys? But Paul Simon has this song that's always in my head called The Boy in the Bubble, where he talks about these are the days of miracle and wonder. And he has this one line about staccatos of constant information. And that's sort of like this tracking data that is at once a huge pain in the ass and the best opportunity in basketball analytics and in soccer analytics for that matter, and in future sports like tennis analytics. Staccatos of constant information. In basketball, that means these cameras that we've all heard about, the sport view system that's installed in all 29 NBA arenas. You can see at the bottom of the frame there, capturing all the locations of the players 24 times a second. We've been talking about this at this conference now for 3 or 4 years. My friend Brian Kopp really got it into the NBA. Now the NBA is adopted. People like Ryan Warkins at Stats are really helping us make important strides in basketball, but it's hard. Again, 10 years ago, the challenge was, where are we gonna get data? Where is this data? Now the challenge is, how can I deal with all this data? And so one of the things I want to talk about is a couple projects my group has worked on and we've done at Grantland with these data sets. So after the Sloan Conference in 2012, Brian Kopp, who was then at Stats, approached me and asked if I wanted to do some academic research with the player tracking data, and I jumped at the chance. I mean, this was incredible. I was so happy about it. And I told the story in a piece I wrote, but long story short is I get the first batch of data and I double click on the file and I'm like, holy shit, I can't do this. This is like XML tags all over my display, and I realized after about 5 minutes I was looking at like 4 seconds of gameplay and I had hundreds of these files and everything was in there, but it was a mess, a beautiful mess. So my friend Luke Bourne, who's here, I told him, he's a professor of statistics at Harvard who studies spatial statistics. And I showed the data with Luke. He's like, hey, you want to do some stuff? And he's like, yeah, that'd be great. And he had the idea to actually form a research group, which was really a really smart thing. So we recruited PhD students in computer science and statistics to really look at this data and say, what can we do with this stuff? And so I want to talk about two of those projects. One was presented here last year, and one will be presented here again in an hour. The first one was presented by Dan Cervoni and Alex DeMore, two of the PhD students. I wrote a feature called Data Ball on Grantland about it. But I'll never forget the moment where this was pitched to me in, 2013 sometime. And Dan and Alex said, we have this crazy idea, and we think we can do it. And the idea was, it was just a crazy idea. So, you know, everybody's talking about how valuable possession is, points per possession, points per possession. They said, with this tracking data, we can learn everything about basketball in the NBA. And we can pause a game at any given moment and assign, based on the configuration of the players and the unique strengths and weaknesses of the players and the shot clock and stuff, we can assign an expected possession value at any given moment. So imagine you're watching a game on League Pass or whatever, and you pause it, and you say, oh, it's worth 0.8 now, 0.8. Rajon Rondo has the ball. He looks like he might shoot. You know, that might be a subpar possession. Conversely, Dwight Howard might have just caught a pass in the restricted area with nobody else around. You pause the game, and he's about to rise up and dunk the ball. So that's probably almost a certain 2 points. And they said, we can look at this data and just estimate those values at any given moment. And then we can look at the actions of the individual players and see which actions and which players are constantly elevating and changing. How important is an outlet pass? How important is an entry pass? How important is a flare? How important is an open shooter without the ball in his hand, about to get the ball? Who are the players that are constantly doing this? In other words, they were going to say, we're going to create a new microeconomics of NBA. We're going to look at the atomic unit and stop talking about just who scored the points. But the analogy we often used was, if SportsCenter showed chess highlights, they would just show the checkmate move, right? Oh, man, wow. That's how I feel when I watch SportsCenter. It's like, thanks, guys. Now I don't care about dunks or home runs. I've seen enough of them. But Olbermann does a great job of actually showing plays that may or may not be more important than those. But in basketball, it's not the checkmate move. It's not the Dwight Howard dunk that is always the thing we want to track. It's what happened. What was the key move in that chess match or that possession that really made that expected value surge or decline? And so, you know, I want to give credit to these three statisticians who were able to pull this off. They did it, and we presented it last year. And I really think it's one of the futures of basketball analytics, a new way to look at it. And to be perfectly fair, it's not a perfect model. It's not perfect right now, but to pull it off, even in this primitive form, I think was a really, really cool project. I'm really proud of those guys for doing it. And we found out that players, unsurprisingly, like Tony Parker, who through a conventional lens, obviously they're very good. But they're even better than the traditional metrics. Because players like Parker are the ones who are causing chaos in defenses, changing the shape of defenses, kicking it out to Danny Green. James Harden is another great example. Sure, he leads the league in points scored, but he also is a nightmare on possessions that don't end with him scoring the basket, as I pointed out, all those corner three assists. You know, giving credit to Matt Bonner for a made corner three is akin to giving Javier Bardem credit for No Country for Old Men. He deserves some of it, but not all of it. 95% of those corner threes are created by a teammate, actions away from the corner. This approach aims to sort of correct the accounting blind spots in basketball analytics. It couldn't be possible without those staccatos of constant information that we now have filling our hard drives at practice facilities and at the NBA league office, and hopefully at ESPN soon. So you can go read that paper if you haven't. I'm really proud of it. I think it was a real landmark and a real demonstration of another concept that I want to say, is that going forward with these data sets, it's going to take many different types of analysts to make progress. Spatial statisticians, computer scientists, visualization experts, writers, communicators, all of these people have a role at the table. There's not going to be any one person that can come in and build something that's going to work for every purpose. There's the Sloan paper on that on project from last year. If you guys didn't see that, this is sort of the things we can do with that model that we couldn't do before. So here's a possession from a Thunder-Spurs game in 2012 or 13, where Kawhi Leonard's holding the ball just inside the three-point arc. And with the model, remember, use our pause metaphor, what happens next? So the other thing this project can do is it can predict what he's going to do, because we've seen Kawhi Leonard hold the ball in this area hundreds of times, and we learned what he likes to do and what the Spurs like to do when he does that. And we did this for every player on every team. And the model estimates that there are two things that are equally likely to happen next. One is he's going to shoot that long two. The current value of this possession, by the way, is 0.88 points. So we're looking at what's likely to happen next, and is that going to elevate or demote the expected value? And since he shoots, I think, like 40% from there, that would actually be a demoted state if he shot. That's not a good proposition. On the other hand, Danny Green in the corner is a very attractive option from an expected possession value standpoint. And if he makes that pass, he would elevate the expected possession value. Right? And if he passes to Matt Bonner, it sort of stays the same. If he passes to Tony, it sort of stays the same. All right, so we're looking at pausing NBA games at any given time, predicting what might happen next, and assigning a value to that transaction, and then looking at which kinds of transactions are really smart. That couldn't be possible. All right, so that's one of the projects I wanted to talk about. The project that I'm really excited about this week is about defense. And we wrote about it on Grantland last week, or this week, I guess. And the students presented it yesterday. And if you haven't seen it, you should go to the main ballroom. I think next session they're going to be presenting it again. But ever since I got that data, obviously a lot of basketball people share this opinion with me. Defense is the most misunderstood, misquantified area of basketball. It's literally half the game, and it's literally 10% of the metrics we have. It's just a big gap. But that gap exists for a reason. You know, conventional basketball reference stats, which I love, not going to talk bad about them, but they're based on conveniently countable things. Steals, blocks, field goals. Defensive play isn't compatible with that sort of accounting framework. It's perpetual. It's ongoing. It's unfolding. And good defenders don't stick out. Sometimes they're like referees. If they do their job perfectly, you don't really notice they're there. It's only when somebody like Brandon Wright Brandon Knight and DeAndre Jordan, you notice, oh, you know that alley-oop play. I wish I had the picture. But most of the time, defenders escape the analytical lens through the tallying system. That can change with player tracking, and that was the goal of this project that I want to talk about, done by Alex Franks and Andrew Miller. So, you know, defense, we all know how many points LeBron James scores in a game. That's very easy. You know, somebody could pull that up on their phone in 30 seconds or less. How many points does he give up in a game? That seems like a nice sort of supplement to that information. So that was the goal of this project. So, you know, I'm going to let this play hopefully a few times to my friends in the back. I wanted this to loop. So what you're seeing here is a lot of modeling at work and a clean map of the player tracking data and a congruent interface to the player tracking data. But we've added some value here. So in this play, we see the Los Angeles Clippers playing the Golden State Warriors. And Steph Curry gets chased off the three-point line by Chris Paul and misses. a shot. So we'll run it back. But what are we looking at on this actual display right now? We're seeing, obviously, dots on a plane. Those are the players being tracked by the sport view system. But the blue lines here, those little unassuming blue lines, are the masterpiece that we're presenting here this week. Or the, maybe it's not a masterpiece, but it's pretty good. It's the relationship, it's our model's estimate of who is guarding who at any given time. So just like the other project can pause a game and estimate the possession value at any given time, this model, we can pause a game and estimate all five pairs of defensive matchups, or who's responsible for who at any given time. So in this example, I believe David Lee gets a foul. We're going to see here it's going to pause. And then after a few seconds, we're going to see a very scary situation for the Clippers defense emerge as a missed shot gets tapped out, and the worst person in the world for that to get tapped to has the ball. Steph Curry, right? Close out. Chris Paul is able to effectively close out and not sort of sell out and stay there, so that when he dribbles inside the arc, he still contests his two-point shot and he misses. We have another example in the paper and in the Grantland article where James Harden is confronted with a very similar situation, and he leaps sort of uncontrollably and takes himself out of the play, and Kawhi Leonard steps into a shot that's open and drains it. So the actions of players like Chris Paul, we all know Chris Paul is a good defender. Hell, he's led the NBA in steals for the last 4 years, but that's not really explanatory. And we believe, like, the player tracking data has other stories to tell about defense. Who suppresses shots on the perimeter the most? Which guys are the most effective? The best way to reduce points in the game of basketball is to prevent your opponent from ever shooting the basketball. And some individuals are really good at that. Some teams are really good at that. It turns out Chris Paul is really, really, really good at that. And so we wanted to look at that. So we built this, we ran these blue lines essentially for the whole year, and we figured out who was defending at the moment of the shot, who was defending for the most of the possession, and we assigned points against. But that who's guarding whom model, the hidden Markov model, by the way, that'll spare you the details, but it's in the paper, that really enables us to achieve a new suite of metrics that help us look at defense in new ways. They also enable us to look at the spatial structure of individual defenders' tendencies and what happens when he's the assigned defender. And so it's the analog to a shot chart is the defensive shot chart that we introduced in this paper. And it says, hey, all right, so for those of you who aren't familiar with my charts, the larger the symbol size means the more active the shooter is. Blue is indicates an inefficient shot, and red efficient indicates an efficient shot. So when James Harden was the assigned defender, I want to emphasize one thing. This was last year, not this year. Opponents shot a lot of above-the-break threes at very high rates. When you compare that chart to Kawhi Leonard above the break, when he was the assigned defender, guys hardly ever shot threes. And when they did shoot, they were reduced efficiency. So everybody knows that Steph Curry is the greatest three-point shooter. Maybe Kyle Korver is the greatest three-point shooter. But who are the good three-point defenders in the league? You know, we're starting to, we have these ideas that Kawhi Leonard is a good defender. But it's sort of unproven in the way that we know that Steph Curry is a good offensive shooter is definitely provable. And this project really helps us close that gap. Chris Paul, I think, in my opinion, was the most impressive person in the study. He does two things that we were looking to find. He suppresses shots better than any point guard in the NBA. So when he guards, and we know, the model knows the tendencies of the players he's guarding. So if he's guarding Rondo and he doesn't take any three-point shots, that's not that impressive in our model. If he's guarding Steph Curry and he doesn't shoot any three-point shots, that's impressive. But Chris Paul is really good at suppressing shots all over the floor. So guys, and he's really important in the contemporary NBA with guys like Damian Lillard and Russell Westbrook and Stephen Curry. Every night in the Western Conference, you have a very good point guard to defend. So Chris Paul's value is immense on the defensive end. He's keeping those guys from getting the regular volume. And when they do shoot, he's disrupting their expected efficiencies. So there's two ways we sort of quantify how good a defender is. A few years ago, there was a debate about who is a better point guard, Chris Paul or Darren Williams. It seems remarkable that that was a debate now, but we didn't have this sort of evidence that said, hey, Darren Williams, he's not bad, that's not bad. But guys shoot a lot of above the break threes. When you're defending point guards, these are the Steph Curry shots right up here, you know. Those are the Damian Lillard shots. 6 points a game, it's just two shots. You leave somebody behind, you get caught behind a screen. Chris isn't giving up those kinds of shots at the same rate. So when we have the debate about who's better, Chris Paul or Darren Williams, now we're getting to a place where we can sort of inform that with, oh, what about this other side of the ball? And then sort of bringing it back to the 2013 paper I presented here called the Dwight Effect, is this approach really looks at interior defense in a cool way too. And we see important differences between Roy Hibbert and Dwight Howard in this slide. Now, if you remember the Dwight Effect, which probably many of you don't, it was the idea that the best way to block a shot is to prevent the shot from happening in the first place. And we only count block shots if somebody thought they were going to get a good shot at the basket. So Dwight and Hibbert, who were two of the most dominant interior defenders of the last 5 years, achieved that domination in very different ways. Whereas Pacers and Hibbert sort of are happy to have guys attack Roy Hibbert and have him sort of contest and protect the rim. Dwight repels guys from even trying that, or whatever tactics they're using in Houston, attacks at the rim when he's the assigned defender, okay? So in our data set, players like Rudy Gobert are getting a lot of shots against them because they're being funneled, they're helping out other players. And then players like Dwight Howard are the opposite. They hardly get any activity when they're the assigned defender. All right, so I'm almost done. So I really think it's a simple question. What is analytics? What are analytics? We need to clarify and expand, in my opinion, the definition of analytics. Get over the whole thing with the scout and the cliche analyst having the debate, agree that maps are or are not analytics, agree that scouting reports are or are not analytics. I have a very broad definition in my head that I'm comfortable with. In fact, my favorite definition of the term analytics is just reasoning artifacts. They're products of analysis that enable us to understand something we didn't understand or characterize something that needs characterizing. The fact that Chris Bosh is left-handed, I agree with some of these people that is something that helps me characterize something. It's the product of an analytical reasoning exercise. But if there's something I could sort of impart on this community, I would say, I think it's really good, using that LeBron example, to blend analytical forms, to blend storytelling, visualization, traditional basketball analytics, video, quotes from players. It's really about integration of multi modes of analysis. And really, the best things, in my opinion, are the ones that, the best organizations, for instance, are the ones that have really good scouts on the same page with their analytics team, on the same page as their coaching staff, on the same page with their front office. And they're all synthesizing all different stuff. And they're coming up with this collective form of analytical reasoning, the superset that's greater than the sum of its individual parts. In that sense, it's like a really good basketball team, where you have different positions, but you work together. And I think a lot of analysts sort of tend to isolate themselves from these other people. We really need to build bridges ecologically between other domains and learn how to communicate better. And as I said, I really think it's only happening more. I saw the Catapult presentation. I see the ProZone guys here. I see Hawkeye from tennis. We're all coming to this new revelation that we were complaining about data for so long, not having it. Be careful what you wish for. That's sort of where we're at. Now we have all this data. What are we going to do with it? The new bottleneck is, what are we going to do with it? How are we going to extract intelligence from these vast haystacks? How are we going to extract the needles from these vast haystacks of data? What techniques are we going to use? So the new bottleneck has to do with extracting intelligence and presenting intelligence. Whereas just 10 years ago, that's not what we were saying. So those are my main points, and that's all I have. So thank you for coming. I appreciate it. By the way, we have time for some questions, but I wanted to thank my friends at Grantland and 538, my collaborators academically, the guys who give me the player tracking data, and lastly, the students that run this conference. This is a wonderful conference. Yeah.
Anyone with questions, just raise your hand and we'll come over.
I got one over here.
Yeah, first of all, thanks. And I find it incredibly interesting, the models being created here, but at the same time, it pains me that I don't have access to this data.
Yeah.
I can't imagine how far basketball intelligence would progress if this was openly available to more teams and more individuals to create statistics and observations about it. Do you think that will happen? And if or if not, is there something that we can do to make that a reality so that more people can work with this data and can do something actionable with it?
Oh. First of all, that's a fantastic question. I couldn't have picked a better question. That's the last thing I trimmed out of this. Like, the data access in all of analysis, like Facebook, AT&T, all these corporations have the best data sets in the world right now, and they're not exactly willing to share those. The NBA has its own version of this right now. My friend and inspiration, John Hollinger, Bill James, these individuals in the proverbial mom's basement, doing the analysis, we're getting access to the same level of data that all the teams had for the most part. Sure, there were some exceptions, but for the most part, they could get almost all the same data the teams have. That's a paradigm shift now. We were very fortunate to get access to some of this player tracking data early on. And make no mistake, that's helpful to our product. But I do think the NBA should do some soul searching about its access. The EPL has a good precedent. I believe it was Man City put out some player tracking data and had sort of a contest. I'd like to see the NBA try to do that. Because you don't really need that much. They can give out a few months of data from 2012-13, for instance, and say, go have at it, kids. But, you know, it's complicated. You know, the flip side of that is, like, the teams who are sort of subsidizing or the league, they don't want other people to have this. So it's really complicated. But from a purely analytical point of view, it's one of the most frustrating things right now for the contemporary analytics community, and the Hollingers and Jameses of the world are not able to sort of emerge from the mom's basement. And I know they weren't in their mom's basements, by the way, but that idea of bedroom analytics, these guys, these rogue analysts, we're kind of suppressing that idea from sort of having the next generation of that with the data access policies that are currently in place. That's a fantastic question.
Here, we got one here.
Where are you?
Thank you for your presentation. Can you talk about UVA basketball and their phenomena with winning with focus on the defensive end? And also, as the analytics increase with defense, do you think that NBA, you'll start seeing more teams that actually brand themselves about being defensive teams to win championships and go to the playoffs?
Well, you know, the University of Virginia is definitely an anomalous college basketball program right now. And I'll be one of the people sort of rooting for them come tournament time. But, you know, don't underestimate that defense is really important in NBA basketball. And there's some stat, somebody knows it in here, but essentially, like, every team that's won the title in the last 15 or 20 years has been a top 10 defense. And many of them have been much higher rated than that. It's also no secret that good defense, which is sort of built on cohesion, tactics, teamwork, effort, blending together, has a correlation with championship basketball. So, I mean, these things go hand in hand. I don't know what the role of analytics here is to help teams get better. I really honestly believe it's about players, and it's about tactics, and it's about effort. And if we can inform some of the tactics or some of the player evaluation process, but I have no illusion that you know, sport view data and a couple of cute animations are going to make, you know, the Utah Jazz an incredible defense. Oh, not the Utah Jazz. That was last year. They're good now. Who's a bad defensive team? The Lakers. I have no illusions that the Lakers are going to watch a couple of animations and go out there and play shutdown defense. So, you know, it's knowing your role in the ecosystem, but I think every little bit helps. And I think from an evaluative standpoint, now from a personnel point of view, we can start to see players what are really good, some guys that might slip through the cracks. The Shane Battier idea yesterday. And one of the goals of the defensive project is sort of to shine a light on the aspect of the game that often gets overlooked, both analytically and from a fan's point of view. But that's a good point, too. Go Cavs, I guess. So. Any other questions? So here we go.
Do you think this sort of spatial analytics could be applied to like secondaries in football with the suppression of route running by receivers and then maybe the disruption when they actually get thrown to? So like maybe like Darrell Revis, when he is thrown to, he'll knock it away, but and then there's Richard Sherman on the other hand who just won't get thrown to at all.
Yeah. So film editors and video editors are some of my favorite people in the NBA. They're the smartest, hardest working in many cases. One of the things about football that occurs to me is they don't have that many. Video is still a pretty good program. They can cut up the video and have every time Revis was thrown at and come up with, you know, there might be 25 times in a season or 50 times where they're looking at that. I'm not sure you need this for that. Although, I'm not against it. In basketball, when we're talking about 82 games, hundreds of shots, you know, there's a lot of signal to be teased out, and you don't want to just do that with video. Although, video is always important. Again, that's more qualitative intelligence, but as I said, it's still important. But football, I know they're tracking. The guys at Catapult are doing good stuff with getting this stuff in there. That's going to help coaches and players. So, I see both sides there.
Time for one more question.
So I come from academia as well, and I thought your point about qualitative and quantitative researchers working together was a really insightful one and a good analogy for kind of, you know, scouts and analytics. So what can you do besides having a great chairman of your department who builds an incredible diverse faculty? Right, carrying the analogy out. Besides having that, what can we do to create that kind of environment and those interdisciplinary teams in a sports context?
That's a really good question, and I think that's one of the things that separates good front offices and bad front offices in sports and good academic departments at universities. And one of my favorite rules is just like the no jerks allowed rule. You know, sometimes it's just like bringing in people who are collaborative in nature and not territorial. And I think that's, from an organizational standpoint, something. But, you know, there's certain people, like, you can see it. Like, who are the people that really respect video? And I learn a lot from video guys. I've talked about them a lot today. But I really just learn a lot from them. They've taught me things to look for then in the data set. And then I can find things in the data set and give them things to look for in the video. That's when you really see it. So in terms of how to create that kind of climate, I do think it's about just hiring the right types of human beings. Having a good sort of organizational blueprint is a big deal, and that's, you know, universities talk about who they're going to hire for the next 10 years in different areas of the disciplines. You know, I think as you bring in more and more analysts into the basketball realm, for instance, you got to bring in guys who are smart about basketball, who are good communicators, and are really good sort of data scientists. The problem, not a lot of those guys. Not a lot of those guys. So that's really the challenge with a lot of these teams, trying to find the right person. Charlie Rolfe is the one who I would say is really good at that, at stats. But there's very few people who blend the actual X's and O's intelligence, communicative abilities, and computational abilities to sort of have that interaction with other people.
Well, thank you everyone for joining us, and thank you again to Kirk.
Thanks.